we're going to continue worshiping this morning by taking communion together. If you haven't received those coming in, will you just shoot your hand up in the air? We just want to make sure that you get some. Do I see anybody? We're good. Oh, there's one. Awesome. Dive in. I just wondered, just holding these in your hand, if you wouldn't mind closing your eyes, just taking a moment to be fully present. Taking some deep breaths. Meditating on what you're holding. We thank you this morning for your body that was broken for us. Your word says, by his stripes we are healed. So we thank you, Lord, for everything that you endured on our behalf. It should have been us. And you took our place because of the joy set before you for all the people in this room 2,000 years later that you had on your mind. That you felt in your heart. Thank you for taking our place. We acknowledge you this morning as our suffering Savior. We acknowledge you this morning as our one true King. You're coming back soon. We thank you for that. It's a privilege to be able to be a part of your church. It's a privilege to get to stand here and remember what you did for us. I pray that we wouldn't be lost on that. That we wouldn't let it become so normal that we forget to feel and to be present in the reality of what you went through. What you accomplished that we couldn't do for ourselves. So together this morning, we take the body of Christ. That Egypt was experiencing, they put a lamb's blood on the doorpost so that anyone, Israeli or Egyptian, the spirit of death would pass through and nobody in the house would be harmed if the blood was on the doorposts. And Lord, we thank you for your blood, the blood of the new covenant. We're found in it, we cover ourselves in it, Lord. Thank you for the pardon of sin. We thank you that the sting of death has been defeated. We thank you for the protection that your blood offers us as your children. And Lord, we continue to acknowledge the blood shed even before you were nailed to a cross. Everything that you endured and all of those hours leading up to that and all of the hours that you endured on the cross on our behalf. What love is this? Thank you that because we're found in you, you call us friend. You said that man has no greater joy than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends. We thank you, Jesus. And we take the blood together this morning. Jesus, we acknowledge this morning that we live in a place and in a time where we are very privileged to do this together, where we don't have to run and hide. We get to freely come in and out of these doors. We get to freely be your church. We thank you for the privilege, Lord, that is. We thank you that you're still moving, that you are alive, that you're still speaking. We just take a moment to just say thank you. To not have any profound thing to say, that is the most profound in this moment, is just thank you. Truly tasted and seen that the Lord is good, our natural response out of gratitude is to give him more and more and more of our life. When we talk about surrendering to Jesus, it's not something that we feel like we have to muster up, or a behavior we have to modify, or a good deed checklist we got to mark off one by one. For those who are in Christ, we are indwelt with the Holy Spirit, and he is the one who empowers us to live like Christ lived. He's the one that counsels us. He's the one that guides us. He's the one that comforts us in our suffering. So, Lord, I ask your Holy Spirit would blow through this place this morning, that you would give courage and boldness to your church to live for you. That you would give the people on this stage a courage and a boldness to live for you. Help us to yield. Help us to give you more. Not because we have to, but because you're worthy of it. And we want to. We want to turn our life over to you, every single part. Even the parts that we feel like we'll never be able to let go of. We ask for your help. We ask you to help us loosen the grip on our life and give you every part. That we would be fully available to be your son, your daughter, to touch the world around us. Because you're still moving in power. Your spirit has not changed since the early church. You are who you are. Help us to just believe and have faith, like little children, that you are who you say you are. And it's not about our push. It's about your presence. To Jesus I surrender all, to him I freely give, and I will ever love and trust him in his breath.
To
shift our worship now into a time of giving. I'm going to invite you guys to take a seat and ask the ushers to come forward. We give because He first gave, just like we love because He first loved. And so when we give every single week, it just helps Timberline Windsor in our community and around the world to help tell people that their life's important, that they matter to Jesus. We want to be a church that gives people hope, extends healing to people, that extends practical ways of helping them, all in the name of Jesus. It's not that we're anything special, but we serve a very special God. We serve a very special person. And so I'm just going to pray over our offering really quick, and the ushers are going to disperse. Lord, we thank You for everything that You're doing in and through this church. We thank You for everything that You're doing in and through Your global church. We're a piece of that. We're a part of the tapestry that You're weaving in history. And thank You, Jesus, that we get to be a part of what You're doing on the earth. You don't need us. I've said this many times. You don't need our help. Even looking back to the Garden of Eden, You gave Adam the ability to work the garden, the ability to name everything that was created. You didn't need to do that, but Your heart from the beginning is for us to be a part of what You have done, what You're doing. Thank You for including us. Acknowledge that it's only because of You that we deserve to be included. So just take what we have to give this morning. Amplify it, magnify it for Your glory. That people would know that there is hope to be found in the person of Jesus Christ. That there's healing to be found. That there are people who care to help. We love You so much, Lord. Thank You for being there with us in all of it, highs and lows. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. So great to see you. What a beautiful and a meaningful morning already we've had together with powerful worship and the deep, wonderful traditions, communion, and offering. And I hope now what is a warm, warm welcome. I'm so glad that you're with us this morning. My name is Linda Motter. I'm your host. And if you're joining us online or here in person, we're just really glad that you're here with us this morning. If you are a first-time guest or a visitor, a very warm welcome to you. We'd love to know that you're here. We have connection cards in person there in the seat back in front of you. We also have a QR code you can scan online or even here. And just let us know that you're here. It's also a great way for anybody to submit a prayer request. If you are a first-time guest or visitor here with us in person, we also invite you to stop back by our Welcome Center and let us give you a little gift and a more personal hello. If you've been around Timberline Windsor long at all, you know that it is our greatest desire for every man, woman, and child to be a part of Connections. These are groups that meet out of Sunday morning, and it is a time to connect more deeply with Jesus and with each other. And fall is a great time to find a place, or maybe a new place, because we have open and rolling enrollment. Can you tell? I'm in college application season at my home. That's key words, though, open and rolling. That means you can jump in at any time. We welcome you to any connection group. So we have them listed here. They're on our website. They're also all on the wall right as around on the left as you exit this morning. And to put our money where our mouth is, we have a really cool connection event because we very much care about the connections in your home, the connection of your marriage, the connection of your family. And so our marriage ministry at the Timberline Fort Collins campus is offering a parent night out. I'm going to rephrase that to a caregiver night out. So anybody that's caregiving for children right now, listen up, because this is pretty cool. It is coming up on Friday. It is from 6 to 8, but there are three really cool hallelujahs coming from a mom's heart. One is it's free. Hallelujah. Okay, number two, childcare. Hallelujah, right? Kids, go have fun. Parents, Pastor Donnie is going to be in with the adults, so that's going to be fun. And the third one is dinner provided. Hallelujah. Okay, so go Friday night, 6 to 8. It's at the Timberline Fort Collins campus in the South Auditorium. But we do need you to register because we want to make sure we have enough food and enough child care workers. So you can scan that QR code. We also have flyers out in the Great Hall for you to grab, get all that information. It is with great excitement that we get to have Pastor Mackenzie Matthews with us today with an incredibly powerful passage. And before that, though, I want to draw your attention to the screens for an incredible testimony from someone who's going to look just a little familiar to you.
When I was 24, 25, just had my first baby, was diagnosed with Lyme disease, intestinal parasites, and just several other co-infections that go with Lyme. And so I really went through a season of, being healthy, loved being outdoors, loved hiking, to being somebody that had a really hard time even playing with her newly born child pretty much. And some days, and being completely honest, it was that I don't have strength to keep living. I want to keep living, but I truly just don't feel like I can. And when you're in something that is chronic and is a long-suffering season, it's very lonely. And it feels like the reality that this is temporary to me doesn't exist. It feels like this is gonna be the way it is forever. I started seeking the Lord every day, and at first it was because I wanted to be healed so bad. I wanted my life back. But it morphed into getting to know Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit differently than I had my entire life, to the point where I remember telling the Lord, if you never heal me, but I experience you this way, that's okay. My secret place at the time was our closet. And I would close the door and I would just spend time with the Lord. And that truly was like a lifeline. For me, like worship got me through that season. When the Bible talks about the joy of the Lord is our strength, it's not poetry, it's true. That when you're going through suffering and you choose to live in heaven's perspective, you choose to live where that's the reality, even more so than what's happening to me, not to dissociate, but to truly just invite whatever God's wanting to do in and through you, something that we're mandated and called to do, that Jesus said that you will heal the sick, you will cast out demons. And I was blessed to be a recipient of people who are laboring in that and who are helping to set people free. I'm really grateful because I know that that's not everybody's story, and it's not that God neglects one person and helps another person. He has a different story and a different journey for all of us. And I think God heals sometimes in a moment certain things, and he reserves maybe some things for a journey. So I think I would just say to anybody who is in the crux of any sort of suffering, especially if it's chronic illness, just to really press into the fact that you're loved, press into the fact that Jesus, his heart is for you, that he still heals, that he still moves, and that he wants to do that for his children. My name is Ashley, and God is big because he always stayed with me.
Can we say thank you to Ashley for that? Yeah. It's powerful, powerful. Well, for those of you I haven't had a chance to meet, like Linda said, my name is Mackenzie Matthews. I'm our Connections pastor at Timberline. I know I haven't had a chance to meet a lot of you, and so I brought a picture of my family. Of course I did, right? Twist my arm. But this is a picture of my family up at our middle school summer camp this summer. It's coming. There we are. That's me. That's my husband, Justin Matthews. People call him J-Matt. He's our student ministries pastor. He's with your middle schoolers. If you have middle schoolers, he's in with them right now. It's a real Matthews takeover weekend. And then that's our son, Powell, who's 4, who's an absolute gem. I have another picture that's really fun as well. I'm pretty sure. It's an exciting, I mean, I could just let the cat out of the bag. But it's, there we go. See, it's kind of like a, it's kind of like a fun reveal, right? I could have just said. But yeah, we're expecting a baby girl come mid-January. And so maybe you would have asked, but it's in your wisdom not to ask a pregnant person if they're pregnant, right? That's wise of you. But I wish I could tell you the background of the story of how generous and miraculous it is. If I gave you just a little snippet for you to understand, for those of you that don't know my story, at the end of 2021, I was diagnosed with an aggressive form of breast cancer. My son was 18 months at the time, and we went through all the treatment things available. Aggressive cancer has aggressive treatment, and we turned over every stone. And at the time, everything shifts, right? We didn't know what we were looking at. I didn't know what would be guaranteed for me at that time. I wanted to be here for the one kid that I have. And I definitely didn't know if we'd ever be able to do this part again. It didn't look promising by any means. It looked pretty dismal, actually, that this would ever get to happen. And here I am sitting on the other side of a hard story, hearing a miracle in my body. And I am so thankful for that. And I resonate with a lot of Ashley's story of where God met me in the middle. And I always want to say that he is faithful, but he's not faithful because I'm sitting on the other end of a hard story with the gift of something that I long dreamed to happen. That's not why he's faithful. He's certainly generous for that. But he can't be faithful to something he didn't promise. That's not how faithfulness works. And he didn't promise me tomorrow. He didn't promise me I'd make it through that. He didn't promise me another baby, definitely, on the other side of that. He promised to be with me. And to that much, he was so, so faithful. And so I stand here with a gift, a generous gift. I don't take it lightly, and I'm celebrating it real, real big, real firmly with you. So thanks for letting me give that long intro. But I almost can't even help it to tell you of like, oh, if you only knew the fullness of what I know and what it feels like to sit in the gift of where I am today. I had to share it. So thanks for letting me do that with you and celebrating with me. As we move into the message today, I got a question I want you to think about. What does it look like to be all in? What does it look like to be all in? Where have you witnessed it? Where have you lived it? What comes to mind for you of examples where people have been all in? Maybe you think of someone, maybe you are this person, very into a fantasy football team. I don't know if that's you, really committed to that. Maybe you think of an elite athlete, a famous athlete that completely changed everything about their life and their lifestyle and their diet and their training and all the things to achieve at the highest level. You might think of a business owner or an entrepreneur who steps out with all of their time and their talent and their treasure to pursue a risky kind of dream. Maybe you think of a missionary or a foster parent, foster family, those who are willing to invest sacrifice personally, to be all in. What comes to mind for you? Those are really wide and far examples, how people might define their goals or what they're just super into at the time, but what investment looks like to be all in. But that's a question I want to think about throughout this whole message. What does it mean to be all in? This is week 4 of our series in the book of Acts, Big God, real church. The book of Acts describes the acts or the actions, the stories, the accounts of God moving in and through the disciples to establish his kingdom after he, Jesus, ascended to heaven. We see God's kingdom coming in ways that people could not have dreamed possible to men, to women, to unlearned, ordinary folks. God built and is continuing to build a different kind of community. Really, community is not even a strong enough word for it. It's like a different kind of family or a movement. His spirit at work in their midst, and we're watching this work itself out freshly in ways that are messy, but also striking. If we were to look at the whole book of Acts or describe the whole books of Acts, it's high drama, high drama, as God's spirit is at work amongst this people with life transformation and this compelling community movement with ordinary everyday people navigating this kingdom life together. Big God, real church. And in this series, we're taking passages sort of episode by episode. If we went verse by verse, we'd be in this series for a million years, 3 years, I bet. But that means that the passage that we have today or allotted for today is far more than I can entirely read or unpack with you in our time together. And there's some riveting stuff that I don't even touch this morning. It's truly compelling. I want to encourage you to spend time this week reading and studying the passage. We are in Acts at the end of chapter 4, all of chapter 5. So if you have your Bibles, you want to turn there, head there. Passages will also be on the screen when we get to them. But remember the question, which is point one of your outline, if you have a bulletin or if you're following along that way. What does it look like to be all in, fully invested? I want to think about what it looked like or didn't look like for them, while also asking, what does this look like for me, for my family, for your family, for this community, for us today? Where are we all in? What are we all in for? And spoiler alert for where we're heading, we're going to see where they were and we're not. All in for generosity, all in for truth, and all in together. All in for generosity, all in for truth, all in together. And this is how it starts, chapter 4, verse 32. All the believers were one in heart and mind. One in heart and mind. What does that mean? We know that this community family movement was made up of men and women, which was radical at the time. Different backgrounds. We know there was diversity in the sense of how we know it. They certainly didn't all share the same preferences, and yet they were one in heart and mind, unified. Unity doesn't mean we're all exactly the same. For them, it was stacking hands on the resurrection of Jesus, believing that part was foundational. For them, it was costly, and it was really the key thing that mattered over preference. And really, we don't know how much preference they would have had at this time. Today, we got a whole lot of preference. We have a lot of thoughts about how church should go. Right? We can access the best teaching, the best worship at our fingertips. You know, we really love those songs. Not those songs, not my taste. Right? I prefer contemplative. I like expressive. I can know so much about scripture and practice and theology. We have so much available to us. When there are people in the world that don't have a Bible in their language, I have 7 that belong just to me. Different versions, commentaries, study resources. It is incredible what we could know, what you could know for free with access to a smartphone right now. And I love that. I love to learn. I do. It's not bad. It's just a difference between us and the early church. How much we can know, how much we can then have strong opinions about, which we can then disagree about. And yet we look at this early church and what did they have? What did their one heart and mind look like? They stacked hands on what mattered most in their belief system. But then they stacked hands quite practically in their everyday daily living. They were all in on generosity. The end of verse 32 says, no one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, They shared everything they had. I wonder if you've had moments in your life when you've shared your stuff or when people shared stuff with you, if you've gotten any echoes of this in your story. Depending on your family of origin, your slot in the childbirth order, you might be intimately familiar with the good hand-me-down. Yeah? Yes. You know what it means to share with your family, right? Often the youngest kid's not, like, stoked about that. Like, yes, hand-me-down. It's often not something that we choose. Have you ever gotten the gift to receive that or to choose that? A few years after Justin and I were married, we'd been living in Southern California. We moved back to the Fort Collins area. We didn't know what we would do. We didn't know where we would live. We didn't have any money, comically little money to our name. We packed everything we owned in a Toyota Corolla with our 80-pound black lab, who was, I don't know how to describe this to you, as needy a creature as they come. Even our dog trainer was like, he's high energy, low focus. That was his description. High energy, low focus. And he remained that way. It's not like, oh, he's just a puppy. I'm like, no, he's eight. Like, that's just who he is at this point. But some of our dear friends, Bob and Roz Seal, invited us to live in their basement while we worked to save money to get back on our feet. We lived with them for 3 months. We ate meals around their table. We sat in their living room watching Survivor. They allowed us and my very invasive animal to live with them, to truly be with them. They did not charge us rent. We did not pitch for food. It is still to this day one of the most tangible expressions of hospitality that I have ever known. Joyfully, they shared with us. Have you ever tasted anything like that? I hope you have. I hope you get to. Verse 33 says, with great power, the apostles continue to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. From time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. It's beautiful. Even the way it's written, just beautiful. God's grace so powerfully at work in their midst is producing this joyful kind of all-in generosity. And we see Barnabas, the son of encouragement. What a nickname that is, biblically. The son of encouragement. We'll see him more. But what Barnabas did by selling land, bringing it to the community, was a notable moment of generosity. This one heart and mind movement of people who gave out of that investment. They're united in mind, but also in literal practical needs of this kingdom life that they're navigating together and they're providing for each other. Barnabas and his land deal generosity moment is the backdrop of the next episode, which I'll say is a passage that can be pretty difficult. It's not one that I delight in teaching. It's hard. It actually often sits with us differently, causes tension within us. And for that reason, I think it's important that we look at it and not skip over it. We got to look at this one to really unpack it. It starts the very beginning of chapter 5. It says, now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Again, we just had Barnabas do this, selling property, put it at the feet to be used for the community, for the whole, Ananias doing the same, right? But he keeps a portion. To me, the first read, you're like, still sounds good. Still sounds generous. But Peter has other things to say. He says, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart, whoa, 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 that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? After it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but to God. Ooh. So we have more going on here. What we have here is a deceit. He lies. He and his wife want to appear as generous as Barnabas while keeping some of the money hidden for themselves. It's a real like perception versus reality kind of moment. And somehow Peter knows this. He has a supernatural insight, what we might call a word of knowledge, where the true motive is somehow revealed to Peter and he calls it out. And Peter's statement, my translation, is like, you didn't have to. You didn't have to do this. Keep it all, give it all, but lie? Like, why on earth? It's important to recognize that he didn't have to sell it and he didn't have to give it all. We continue to see that generosity, the all-in generosity, it's out of joy, not out of force, that they radically share. They choose, they're not obligated to do this. Even Peter's response, didn't it belong to you before it was sold? After it was sold, wasn't it still yours? There wasn't an expectation to do this, but it highlighted something else, something apparently that was threatening to the whole. The early church was all in on truth. This is a place where we see a really hard line drawn on that. Verse 5, when Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who heard what had happened. Then some young men came forward, wrapped up his body, and carried him out and buried him. About 3 hours later, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Peter asked her, tell me, is this the price you and Ananias got for the land? Yes, she said, that's the price. Peter said to her, how could you conspire to test the Spirit of the Lord? Listen, the feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door. They will carry you out also. At that moment, she fell down at his feet and died. Then the young men came in, finding her dead, carried her out, buried her beside her husband. Great fear seized the whole church and all who heard about these events. Yeah. Youch. This is bizarre. It's a difficult account. It's scary. It's sobering. And in the biblical landscape, it's not very common, which is why I think it's important we drill down a bit. Most of the time, when people or we see entire nations do wrong, they get away with it for a really long time. And when judgment does come to them, it's often not as you would expect. But Ananias and Sapphira lie and die. They lie and die instantly. There's no moment for them to repent, which we would much prefer, right? For them to be confronted, to confess to the community, to start again. Give it all, keep it all, or having an opportunity for them to be renewed, to be restored, for them to grow. That's how we would have loved this story to go. That is how most often the gospel comes to each of us, an opportunity to repent, to be redeemed, to be transformed. But here, there isn't that opportunity. Instead, swift judgment falls on both of them, and we don't know why. We don't know why there's not a moment for repentance or forgiveness. We also don't know what came before this. Ultimately, we don't know their hearts. We don't know. We read it, and it feels harsh, real harsh. This isn't the only place we see sudden death judgment biblically. There are moments in Scripture elsewhere, several moments of what God commanded for temple behavior, where there's the hot spot of God's presence, where that rested specifically in the Holy of Holies, in the inner sanctuary of the temple, where God's holiness would be so palpable that there would be no space for a breach of it. We see in Leviticus 10 a story of two brothers who lackadaisically approach the sanctuary and they die. We see a man named Achan who takes items from the temple, things that were set apart and devoted to God. He takes them, the whole community starts to suffer. He's found out and dies. In 2 Samuel 6, we see Uzziah, who is a Levite. He was trained in handling the Ark of the Covenant, and he's moving it with a whole procession of people, and David's dancing. They're bringing it back to Jerusalem, and it wasn't to be touched. It was actually supposed to be carried on poles. In that account, it was being carried by an ox cart, and in the move, it looks like it might fall. Uzziah reaches out to steady it. He touches it, and he dies. So there are multiple places where we see kind of that swift judgment result in death. All of these examples are the temple, like presence of God related. And we have to remember the early church just experienced Pentecost. the moment the presence of God came and rested upon them. If you think about it, when God's presence led Israel in the desert, how did it come? How did it manifest? It was a pillar of fire and a cloud. When God's presence filled the temple, how did it come? Fire coming down. When the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost, how did it come? Acts 2 describes it. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated. It came to rest upon each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues, other languages, as the Spirit enabled them. Can you imagine? I have this print in my office of Pentecost. It's by an artist. He's actually an AI artist named Merrick Portichu. I think that's how you say your name. I hope I'm saying it okay, in case you ever hear it. I want to say it right, but I love this print. I love it so much. It's a sweet reminder to me of God's nearness and presence with us in this community movement of his kingdom that we're a part of. It's a stylized depiction of what we're talking about, the flame, the fire over their heads. They are being established as the new temple where the presence of the Holy Spirit resides no longer in a structure, instead in the individual parts that make up this collective group, in them and in us. This shift, cataclysmic, huge. God's Spirit, God's temple in you and in me, men and women, all tribes, all languages together. It's stunning. We see it in 1 Corinthians 6 saying, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? We remember the temple, the holiness of it, this foundation, the moment we come to Ananias and Sapphira. We remember the timeline. It's recent. Now, we don't know why things happen just like this, but we do know that what they are claiming is not congruent with what was true of them. There's deceit at play, and that was threatening enough to the community, the movement as a whole, for it to bring judgment upon them instantly. We're all in on truth. The deceit of this moment makes me pause to ask or want to look inward, to look for places of deceit within me. So the second point today, if you're following, is can we see ourselves in the light? Can we see ourselves in the light? Could we see ourselves rightly? Are there places I am living that are not true to what I say? Do I have the courage to look at that honestly? To look at who I am and who I am becoming? Dallas Willard said, the main thing God gets out of your life is not the achievements you accomplish, it is the person you become. Not your accolades, but your person, who you are, the person you become. What is true of who I am today? What is true of you? Now, God certainly knows what is true of our hearts, where we're really at, how in we really are, what we claim, and the perception versus reality continuum. He exists fully in reality, in truth. Where there are places of inconsistency and compromise in each of us, God is not fooled. He's not surprised. We read in Galatians 6, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The real you, the real me, our motivations, our intentions, our compromises, our flaws, our faults, our humanity, the truest us, God knows us. We can't fool him like we could with one another. I cannot present a brand of myself to God. I cannot curate my vibe or edit my appearance or my resume before him. Like, he gets the real deal. The real deal me. The real deal us. We see the stark ways Jesus spoke to the religious leaders who looked pious on the outside, and they were self-righteous. But their hearts told a different story. We see Jesus quote Isaiah to them, which is, they would have known. It would have been a whole thing. But in Matthew 15, he says, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Bold, but true. He knows us better than we know ourselves. We see this prayer at the end of Psalm 139. It says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting." What a prayer to pray. Reveal what must be revealed in me, O God. Talk about bold. How is it with my soul? How is it with my heart? What is true of me? Am I all in on truth? And what does that look like before God? Proverbs 9:10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom." The fear of God is the starting point of wisdom. We often think of fear to be scared or to be startled. Maybe we think of a phobia, like snakes, small places, to feel afraid. Really, fear of God is a reverence for him, living in a way that reveres God in my life. And that is really an invitation to holiness, to pursue holiness, to revere him in my habits, to revere him in my speech, to revere him in how I spend money, to revere him in how I scroll, or how I watch Netflix, or how I shop online, or how I eat meals, to revere him. How might I revere him, even think of him there? You know, Erwin McManus said, "Whatever you fear dictates the limits of your freedom." So if you fear heights, you won't go up. If you fear people, you'll stay in. If I fear God, it opens me. I won't want to move outside of him. I will want to revere him. A.W. Tozer said, "What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us." When we read accounts like Ananias and Sapphira, it can scare us a bit. It might be easy to slip into that afraid place. We might be afraid of God, afraid to be seen in the light as we really are, afraid that we would be condemned by him. So if you were here, or if you're even listening to the sound of my voice online, we have to take a moment to turn back to him. What we most often see biblically is incredible patience from him. Wild, undeserved grace. Over and over, we see God is patient. God is kind. He is slow to anger. He is rich in love. He is most often not giving us what we deserve. Instead, he's covering us again and again with mercy and loving kindness, delighting in us like a perfect dad would delight in his kids, calling us beloved by him. Psalm 145 says, "The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in love." 2 Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." We hold the reality of the accounts of Ananias and Sapphira alongside the reality of who we are in the light, alongside the reality of who God is and what Jesus' death and resurrection really means for us. What is true of you? Yes, may we see ourselves rightly in light of reality, but in that same light, might we see the gaze of our Heavenly Father who looks upon us with love, a good and gracious Father. Both true. All in on truth. Now, one thing that's as clear as day this scripture condemns is lying. It's the power of a lie, which I want to talk about for just a moment, that third point. What does a lie do? What does a lie do? Does a lie matter all that much? We're in an interesting moment in our culture where, unlike I ever remember it before, we question what's real. We question if something is true or if it's a lie. We hear half-truths or completely spun untruth all day long. If I were to ask you, if I had a poll, like, how common is lying? Like, what would you say? How common it would be interesting to hear what people would say. You know, Pastor Foth and I, he was here a couple weeks ago. He's teaching the same passage at our Fort Collins campus. We got together several times to talk about the passage, but when he was parenting, he was told, well, all kids lie. All kids lie. Do they? All people lie. Do they? I'm in a stage of parenting right now that I'm trying to teach our four-year-old son the importance of telling the truth. He's so fun. He's in such a fun stage because it's like all make-believe and imagination and made-up words and stuff. It's really cool. But we're also talking about what's true, and Justin and I really want to instill in him, like deep down, what's at stake for telling a lie, why it should matter if we tell the truth or not. Like our words, they matter. They carry weight. When we tell lies, we break relationship. Telling lies breaks relationship. If you lie to me once and you tell me something after that, I might question if you're telling me the truth. If you lie repeatedly, you might end up lying to yourself, which makes it near impossible to meet another person in a place of reality, right? In a place of truth. Lies have power. The great fall at the beginning of Genesis started with a lie, with a deceit. Did God really say that? Really? The response is a ripple effect. And Jesus himself said, the truth will set you free. So what's the opposite of that? Lies break relationship with yourself, with people, with God, and the truth sets you free. So why does it matter? For you, for them, for us. The last point today is what God does for us personally is ultimately for us corporately. All in together. They were all in on generosity, all in on truth, and all in together. Looking at this account, at the whole book of Acts, this whole thing was about them, this community movement, all in family, the impacts their decisions had on the whole. It's this together people. It's the container of the Holy Spirit, the container of the suffering and the joy and the boldness and the security and the healing and the perseverance. What God wants to do in his kingdom is through the container of this community, of this church. What God does for us personally is together for us corporately. We are that container. So the question, what does all in look like? In our modern era, what is all in on generosity and all in on truth and all in together? What does it look like for us, for you? Where are you in light of this today? I want to take a moment to take a few deep breaths before we pray that you might pay attention to any tension this brought up for you in this passage. Let's say pay attention to the tension points and to bring that before the Lord. But take a moment to take a few deep breaths together. Father, we are grateful that we are breathing today and have an opportunity to come to you today. Repentance, forgiveness is available to us and we have it. We can ask for it. I pray you would help us to see ourselves rightly, to see ourselves in the light, to know what is true of us, but in that same light, God, that we would look to you, that we might see your face looking back at us, smiling in love, in grace. But we have to confess, we bring before you whatever on our hearts and our minds right now, we place before you. Where we need healing, for anyone in this room or listening to my voice needs healing in their body, we pray for that. We ask for your spirit to move in ways that we cannot control. We can't control that. We don't command healing, but we certainly want to obey and receive what you might do. And whatever you might have us do to be a vital part of this together community family movement of your church. We want that, God. We want that. We pray for that. We worship you. We honor you and we revere you for who you are. We love you. Amen. Amen. We're going to have a moment to worship a bit more, to let this settle in us. So if you'd stand, if you're able, let's sing one more song. Benediction this morning. I wonder if you might read with me. How do we feel about reading a prayer together aloud? You're game for it? I didn't write this. This is from Practicing the Way. I highly recommend you look them up, practicingtheway.org. But This is a prayer that I want us to recite as we leave. Ready? Good Creator, who made our inmost parts, you see more of us than we do. You know us better than we ever will, and yet you call us beloved. Give us courage to see ourselves in the light, to be honest with who we are and what we're not, that in our being fully seen by you, we may be transformed ever more greatly by your love into your holy image. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys for being here. Bless you guys.